Insert programming language. Next question. What can you use it for? Well, you can make web pages sing and dance with like dynamic animations, and you can register quick handlers so you click a button and it pops up a message or it moves some stuff around on the page. But you can also use it on the command line to write programs that do things with your system, with your files, and you can write network servers that speak over the network to other protocols. So, but right now, today, we'll just be focusing on the language. So I'm only using a few things that are kind of specific to Node, because that's how we'll be running these programs. But you should install Node.js if you haven't already, because we'll be using that to run these examples, because this kind of builds on the a little bit of the previous Unix stuff, not very much, but we'll be in the command line. So, first of all, let's write the program. So, if you make a file, call it like robot.js or whatever, just type this in. If you don't know what it means, that's okay. You just have to kind of accept it. This console log part is a little bit magical, but you do console log, then open quote, a message, close quote, and then close paren. Make sure to get every single thing. Quotes, parens, everything. And once you've typed this in, you can do node, and then the name of your file. So you should get a message like this. Here's the program again. So what we're doing here is we have this thing, which I'll get into later, called a function call. There's a dot in there, which will be explained. But for now, just accept that this is how you print messages to the terminal, console.log. And this thing in here is called an argument, which I'll get into a little bit more later. So, beep boop, that's our first program. You run it just by saying node and then typing the name of your program. And then once you've got something printed on the terminal, can you raise your hand? That would really help me out.
Does anyone else have trouble finding it once they download Node.js on there?
You might have to type Node.js, which is silly, but I can show you how to fix that later. Otherwise, just do Node. Okay, so this is the main point where I want to make sure that most people have gotten at least as far, because.
How many folks are installing Node?
Anyone installing Node? Okay.
I did also.
Okay, great. So, I hear a lot of typing still. I don't know if I should wait a little bit more.
I have a different question.
Yeah.
How do you, on Vim, how do you switch from your console to your editor?
One easy way is to do Control Z, and then you'll just drop it down into the console.
So,
and to pop back, just do FG.
Not doing anything on mine. I tried Command Z and Control Z.
A Mac. I don't know, Macs are weird.
I think Shift Z.
Never mind.
It's Shift Z.
You might need Capital Z.
You can also do WQ, right?
Yeah, you can just quit from Command Z as well. Okay, so I think I'll move on now, and I'm gonna go faster, so be warned. Okay.
How many people got it now?
Raise your hand if you got it to print something, if you got a program to print. Raise your hand.
Did you get it to print?
No.
No?
I'm trying to connect to the internet.
Do you have Node?
You
don't need the internet. You can just run this program. Just do that. Don't try to connect to the internet. Don't try to do anything else. Just do this.
When you install Node, does it become accessible throughout your entire system?
Yes. Yeah, it should be Node, or if you're on a system that tries to make things hard, it might be called Node.js.
Is there anybody who doesn't have Node?
We have a chair over here.
Are there other people who don't have Node?
Okay, so we're still right at the start, so gotten this, you can get it running later, but, okay. So, how does this work, this program that we just did? So, console.log, as I said, is a function, and it prints its arguments. So, the things that you put in between the parentheses are called the arguments. We had one argument, which was a string called bfoo. So, strings are separated by quotes. If you want multiple arguments, you separate them by commas. So, it's a little bit similar to mathematical notation. You use that for functions like sine or cosine. And the other thing that console.log does is it prints a new line automatically after the result. So, for example, you can... sometimes arguments also are called parameters, so don't be tripped up. Those are basically the same word. So if we want to have a program that prints two statements, we can do console.log a first thing, like a cool, and console.log a second thing, like beans. So you just put one after the other on separate lines. Just like with shell scripts, right? Just stack commands one after the other. So to do cool beans, then you just do node, and then you have your program again, and you should get cool beans. So these things are called statements. A statement is kind of like an instruction. It's like, do this thing. And statements, we'll see a lot of these, but they're mostly separated by new lines, although you can also separate statements with semicolons. So, for example, we might want to separate them like this. That's also the same thing. Yeah. So, you might see programs with semicolons. You might not see them. They're optional. So, I'm using them, and I'm not using them in these slides, because it doesn't matter, pretty much. Another kind of statement is called a variable declaration. This is a way of kind of storing a value for later. Like we can have var x equals 5, var y equals 111, and we can do this thing inside of console.log, which is an expression. So it's just like, it's called infix notation. It's from mathematics. So stars multiply, we can do x times y in the arguments of console.log, and that will print. This part will print 5 times 111, which is 555. And then we can have more statements, so we'll declare two more variables, A and B, to be beep and boop. Now, a little bit of a strange thing you can do with strings is if you use the addition operator with strings, it will concatenate them, which is to put them side by side. So this will print 555 and the string beep boop, all one word. So we can do var x equals 5, var y equals 111, so log x times y, like that. And we can declare more variables later if we want, like cool, and then var b equals beans. We console log a plus b, run this program, we get 5 by 5, and cool beans, one word. So these characters, like plus and star, are called operators, or arithmetic operators. I mean, in this case, it's not really, because it's strings, but these are kind of the basic building blocks of expressions. So that's what variables look like. You can think of variables kind of as little boxes that you can put values in. So but we've already seen some kinds of values, like strings, which are surrounded by quotes, and numbers, which are like the number 5, or the number 1.2. They can be floating point, or they can be integers. JavaScript, actually, everything is a floating point number, but you can kind of pretend like there's integers. So here's some other operators you can try. So we've already used multiply and divide. Like, we use multiply right here, and plus. So we can add things, we can multiply. The same precedence rules for mathematics hold for JavaScript. So if you do x plus y times 2, y plus y times 2 happens before x plus y times 2. So this will be the same as you might be used to in math. So that program, right, let's see, y times 2, 222 plus x plus 5. So that would be 227, I think. And it is. Cool. So, some more operators. There's like the usual suspects, right? Add, subtract, minus, multiply is star. Divide is forward slash. This one is really useful, but it's... So, you might remember from like third grade, the remainder of division. So, this is called modulo. And it's used all over the place in programming because it has this nice property where if you kind of go past a number, it'll wrap back around. And that's really handy because a lot of data structures, you don't want to run past the end of them. You want to kind of continue on from the start again. So you can try some things in the console. Like we can have some values like 3 and 4. You can do console log. 3 times 4, which should be 12, and then you can do like modulo 5. So this will be 3 times 12, or sorry, 3 times 4, which is 12. Modulo 5 means divide by 5, but throw away whatever the integer part is and only look at the remainder. So 12 divided by 5 is 2, and the remainder should be 2, because 10, and then we have 2 left over. So this should print 2. Whoa. So if we print robot.js, yeah, we get 2. Great. Just like we expected. Cool. So, let's move on. So there's another way that you can test out these arithmetic expressions pretty quickly. I won't be covering it too much because it can be a little bit confusing, but there's basically a calculator mode in Node. If you just type Node on the command line, this, you get this little caret, and you can type expressions into it, like 1 plus 3 times 2, for example. You can have variables if you want. So, do like x times 11, 55. This is kind of a handy way for testing out things before you put them in your code.
Is this like an arcane with a console? In like DevTools or something?
This is in the command line.
Yeah, but is it the same sort of?
Yeah, so in browsers, yeah. You have this basically the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And to exit the console, do Control D. And that will that tells the standard A to like finish. That's how the console the REPL works. So go ahead and try a few little expressions if you haven't already. So the next thing we can start to do is we have variables, but they're not permanent. They can change their values over time. So if we want to change the value of a variable, variable x. It starts out being 5, but we can do this sometimes called the destructive update, where we take x, and now the new value of x is the old value of x right here, which was 5, plus 10. So when this statement finishes, x should be 15. And if you try that, it is. So we can do the same thing over here with our old program. So if we have x equals 100, we can set x equals x times 2. So now x should be 200. And it is. Cool. There's some other nifty ways of doing... there's some nifty shorthands for this kind of thing, because it's very common to say x equals x plus 5, for example. So there's this shorthand called plus equals, and if you use plus equals, that's the same as doing, like, this says x equals x plus 10, but you put the plus in front of the equals to say that this like, addition operation applies to the left-hand side of that expression. So we can use an assignment operator, keep x as 100, and we can do, like, x plus equals 40, so x should be 140, or we can do something like x times equals 3, so that will take, this is the same as x equals x times 3. Or we could do division, we could do modulo, we could do any one of the arithmetic operators that we've already seen, including minus. So, just to prove that to you, I'll run the program. Under 3, perfect, that's what we'd expect. And here's kind of a little list. Basically, just take any one of the arithmetic operators and add an equal sign to the end. So, there's another form of this kind of expression called increment and decrement. That's where this is doing the same as x plus equals 1, x plus plus, which is the same as x equals x plus 1. This is another kind of shorthand, because programming is, especially at the expression level, is littered with these kinds of little shorthand. So if we want to just do x plus equals 1, we could do it that way, or we could do plus plus. And that goes for minus minus as well. So x minus equals 1 is the same as x minus minus. And you'll see these a lot in for loops and places like that, which we'll go into later.
Are all the spacing, the way that you're spacing everything as far as using literal spaces to be everything, is that absolutely required?
No, it's not. You can use whatever you want. You can even go like this. You can go like that. You can like move that over there. You can move this over here. You can get rid of semicolons. Do that. Yeah, you can make your code as pretty or as ugly as you want by doing white space, although it's rather common to not do that.
Sure.
Yeah. Let me just make sure that that works. That looks. Oh. So. Hang on. I know what it is.
Okay.
In this case, I actually needed a semicolon.
The point was that I could potentially remove
the spaces. Yes, you can remove spaces from this part. Oh, hang on. I think I did something else. But basically, you can add spaces. Don't do that. But you can. Yeah. Okay. Cool. So increment. Decorant, plus plus, minus minus. So, booleans, what are they? Booleans are true or false. It's like 1 or 0. These are just values that map to a single bit of information. So it has two states. Where these appear are these other set of operators called comparison operators. So with comparison operators, you get back as the result of the expression a boolean about whether two things are equal or there are all of these inequalities, like less than or equal to, greater than or equal to. There's also negation of that, which is like not equal to. So for example, we have two values, like 5 and 4, and we console.log a equals b. That's 3 equals because the version with 2 equals does something else, so it's good to stick to the 3 equals version for now until we get it to type coercion. So if you do that, it's false because A is not equal to B, but if we change one of them, one or more of them, to be equal, then we will get back true. So there's also the opposite of that. So this says, and in place of the variables, you can also just use the values directly. So variables are very much just placeholders. You can always take the value that a variable would have and put the actual thing in its place. But it's also kind of handy to use variables sometimes. So there's not equals, there's about less than, greater than, less than or equal to, all in the notes. So here's some values. So we can do x is less than 6, which is true, x is equal to 2, false, it's 5, x is not equal to 5, which is false because it is equal to 5, and x is greater than or equal to 5, which is true because it's equal. So you get some results back, and you can always console log pretty much any value to see what something is. Just looking at it. So, we can start to take some of these kinds of expressions and we can chain them together with these operators. So, we've got ands, which is two ampersands, or, which is two pipe characters side by side, and not, which is just an exclamation mark. The not one is a little bit special, and I'll show you why in a second. But it's a unary operator, so it only applies to one argument, not two. So if we want to play around with logical operators a little bit, so we can define like three values, right? 3, 4, 5, good Pythagorean triple there. So we can go A is greater than 4, which would be true, and then we can say, and C is less than 4, which would be false.
Wouldn't A greater than 4 be false?
Yes, that's true. So this would be false, thank you, false, and a false statement, which is false, because with the and operator, if the left-hand thing, if either the left-hand thing or the right-hand thing is false, the whole expression is false. So both have to be true, the outcome to be true. There's also the or operator, where if either one of those expressions on the left and the right is true, the whole thing is true. So we can have, we can just change that to be C greater than 4, and now the whole thing is true, even though the first one is false. And there's also not, so if we take this whole expression and put it in parentheses, we're using or, so this expression is true right now, but if we throw an exclamation mark in front, now it flips the value, and now it's false. So, I think I've got some examples. Alright. So here's some examples you can try where we just set Boolean values directly. So JavaScript true and false are already available as like values, and you can just do and or, and you can chain them together as much as you like. Yep.
What is the dash dash then?
That is called a comment. So the comment just means ignore everything that will happen on the rest of the line.
Question. So when you're saying it switches a value, so then x is y and y is x, is that what you mean?
No.
By
switch the value, I mean if something was true, the expression is now false.
The outcome will just be
opposite? Yeah, it's the outcome, but it doesn't modify anything. It only changes what the
result
is.
That's pretty useful. That's cool.
Yep. Yeah, so handpicked.
So the comment will only go until the end of the line, and then on the next line it will read as code, or do
I've got another page of text, but questions about logical operators, they're pretty handy. Question.
What's the main use for having true and false?
So true and false will come in just a little bit when we talk about this thing called conditionals. So there are all of these control flow statements that you give them a true or false value, and they will do something or not do something, or repeatedly do something. While that condition is true, for example. Okay, so logical operators. So comments. Comments are that little forward doubled slash thing that we just saw. So comments are really handy because you can make notes for yourself in your code, or you can take a piece of code and kind of disable it so that the computer will just skip right over it. So we can make a little note to ourselves by just putting something with a comment. And then everything after that comment operator will be ignored. So if you put one at the beginning of the line, it's just like an empty line. You can also have multi-line comments, and those begin with a forward slash and a star, and they go line by line, as many lines as you want, until you get to a star forward slash. So that's just something you might see. So, how can we use these conditionals that we just saw? A moment ago. Well, use them in these statements. If is a handy little statement. It takes. So you give if a conditional expression, always between parentheses. So we can give it if x is less than 10, console.log. Wow. And that program, because x is indeed less than 10, 5 is less than 10. Should print wow. So if I just do that real fast, x is 5, if x is less than 10, this is an important part too. You have to do an opening get. Cool. Great. Whoops. If we make that false, though, like if x is greater than 10, nothing will happen. So that code will not be run. And you can do everything that we saw in the previous expression with combining different conditionals. So if we have like another value in and so maybe the first one is true, but the second one is false, so and will make the whole thing false. And y is greater than 4. So now nothing will happen, but we change that to be true. So you can combine things, you can add nots in there with the exclamation mark. And make programs that either do something or do nothing. So there's another form of these if conditions called else. So else is something that you can stick after an if to do that thing instead. So back in our program here, we can add an else and then an opening curly brace and a closing curly brace, and that will do like this will give us kind of like a fallback for when the if part doesn't fire. So now it will either print cool or it will print whatever, depending on if the first conditional matched or not. So for in robot.js it says cool, but if we change the condition so that it fails, then we get the other case, which is whatever. Doing that. Great. Conditions. If and else. Makes sense. Okay. Great. So there is yet another kind of condition called else if, and you can use that to chain together multiple cases. So for example, we can have if and a condition with some case, like some code that will fire when that condition is true. We can have else if, which has another condition, and then we can put an else at the very end that will only ever fire if the first two conditions, the if and the else if, did not match. So if that code didn't fire. So we have like these three cases, basically, these three states that our program can be in, depending on what matched. And JavaScript proceeds from the first expression to the second expression to the third one. So if x is 22, but the first one matched, it wouldn't jump down to see that this condition. It proceeds in order, and the first one that matches gets kind of like, okay, it wins. It wins the condition. Question.
And then it'll skip to the end of the statement and keep going in the program? Like, say the first part gets executed, so the body of the first if statement is executed.
Yes.
Then after that, it will skip to the end of this whole
if-else-if chain. Exactly. So if you have code, I could have an else if or not. It's not too important. So once all of your code from your if blocks fires, then it will jump to right here. And then this part always happens, right? Mm-hmm. So that message will always get printed. Great question. Okay. So if, else if, and else, the kinds of ways that you can create conditions. So what's cool is you can also nest conditions inside of one another. Because what happens inside of the braces, the opening brace and the curly brace, is just whatever kind of code you can do everywhere else. You could put another if in there, that's fine. You can put any kind of statement inside of that block. So you could have some code where you have if x is less than 5, then you print a message, but maybe otherwise you do some other computation, and that can involve ifs and elses and else ifs and whatever you like. So that's just something that kind of naturally follows from how if and else works. So you'll notice in this example I'm indenting, right? I'm adding spaces on the left to kind of make it easier to read how this code works. So this is a very common thing. Some programming languages enforce that you must put indentation, but JavaScript doesn't. So you could could write your code without any of these spaces in front, or and it would still work, but it's much nicer to read it if you kind of have flow in your program. So this is where a nice text editor is written for programmers very good, because they will automatically do indentation for you when you use tab and hit enter. They'll fill in the appropriate levels of indentation. So the important thing about indentation is that things happen in levels. So we've got our main program, which is like level zero, right? There's no spaces. And we put statement after statement, but whenever we go into a kind of a new place, like we have an opening curly brace and a closing curly brace usually, then we add a new level of indentation. So you should pick a number of spaces or tabs. Sometimes it's not as common anymore, but so like it's common to use two or four spaces to kind of give for each level. So here we have one level, and I'm using four spaces, so that's four spaces. But later, here I'm at level one, but then I jump into a new condition, and I jump to like level two. So now I'm using two of those four spaces, or eight spaces. And another thing too is it's really nice if you're careful to align the closing curly braces with the opening statement that it refers to, because then you can actually see like where your code ends a little bit easier. Of course, none of this is hard and fast. You can do whatever you want, but if you do it this way, it'll be a little bit easier, I think.
So it doesn't actually affect the code, it just gives you a better view of your code.
Yes, exactly. So this is just a really common thing that programmers do to make their code easier to read, and especially to make it easier for other programmers to be able to read their code. And the biggest rule of indentation is, so like here's using four space indentation, so each block gets a new level of indentation. It's like two spaces is also common, or some people use tabs. Whatever you use, just be consistent. Be really pedantic about being consistent, because it makes code much easier to move around later, and it makes code much easier to refactor and read, and to actually figure out what your program does when you come back to it 3 months later and you have no memory of writing it. So, indentation, blocks. The next thing that I think is really fun to cover is this data structure called arrays. So what arrays are is they are ordered sequences of values. So an array could be 3, 2, 5. So if we print that out, we will get, so, or you can call your array whatever you want, like variable names, or make up whatever you like for that. 3, 4, 5, if we print that out, we'll get a string that looks like 3, 4, 5. Nothing too interesting there. Whoa, there we go, 3, 4, 5. So we can print arrays. It's not really doing anything with them yet. But so the first thing that we can do with arrays is to use square brackets to pick out individual values. So if you have a variable called array, it has some values in it, we can use an opening square bracket and a closing square bracket with a number to pick out, in this case, element 0 or element 1, element 2. So this counting scheme starts from 0. And if we run this program, we'll see the output first is 1, because it's this element. Second, which is array of 1 with square brackets, is 4. And the third one, which is array of square brackets 2, is 9, which we see there. So it's a little bit different from how we sometimes otherwise talk about arrays, where we might index by 1, but in JavaScript you always index by 0, which has some nice mathematical properties, especially with modulo, but there are reasons why it is this way. Not all programming languages are 0 indexed, some are 1 indexed. I don't recall offhand which
Lua.
One. Which one?
Lua.
Lua is, I think Fortran might be as well. But C is not in JavaScript, borrows a lot from C in languages before. Yeah.
Can you set it to an empty array?
Yes, you can. So to do that, So right here we're using square brackets to have our list of things. So just like a function can take no arguments by just having open paren, close paren, you can do the same thing with an array. You don't want any values, just do open square bracket, close square bracket. That will be an empty array. So, yeah. I'll get to that in a bit. So, yeah. Yes, you can assign values for indexes. Right. Oh, actually, I might not have a slide for that. But
you can't. Index 1, 2, 3, it's just whatever's in the first spot, whatever's in the second spot, whatever's in the third spot.
Yeah, but if like you set something in the first spot and the last one, that there's nothing in the middle.
Right. So, in that case, you'll get undefined. So, if I have, like, if I have an array with only two elements, but I try to, I haven't covered this, but I'll cover it now. So, if I try to set, like, array 5, which would be the sixth element, then I'll actually get, they're called holes in the array. So, these are just empty values that are equal to undefined. So, there's this special thing in JavaScript called undefined. So if I do XS of something that doesn't exist, I get undefined as the result. It's like, I don't know what that is. That's what the computer says.
But the length will still be like 6.
I'm not sure what the length is offhand because I don't really use, I try to avoid holes, but we can see what it would be. Yeah, so the length would be 6. So it treats it as if you like skipped in all the way in. Yeah. But that's kind of a technical detail of how they're implemented in labor. So, one fun thing we can do with arrays is index by variable. So, just like how we can kind of substitute anywhere a value for a variable, you can do the same thing with arrays. So, if you take array of n, for example, which is a variable, this will be array of 2, which will be 9, because it's the third element index 2. So, you could also use any expression, so any arithmetic expression you want, you can stick between the square brackets. That's kind of a recurring pattern. Whenever you have somewhere where you can normally stuff a variable or a constant, you can always put a little bit of code in there. It's like a little expression. So I can show you what that might be. So if I fill it some more numbers, and I do console.log array of 2, times 3 minus 4, then that will be our element 2, which should be 5. And it is, cool. So this turns into 5, or sorry, this turns into 2, which if you go 0 is 3, element 1 is 4, element 2 is 5. So one thing, we just talked about this a little bit, is length. So with any array, you can do this thing, which we'll get into later how this works behind the scenes. But if you put a period and length, then it will tell you how many elements are in an array. So we can do r.length, which in this case would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we would get 5. Another fun thing, just like how we can substitute variables and expressions, you can take this array, we can take this array, and we can just move this entire definition into right there. If we only ever use it once, then that's also the same thing. Recurring theme, keep that in mind, so that you can pretty much always do this kind of trick. It's like a substitution principle that's kind of borrowed from a lot of algebra. So, those are the same. Some more things that we can do with arrays are, there are a bunch of, they're called, any questions? Any more questions? Yep.
You can mix and match types in an array, right?
Yes, you can mix and match types. So, we can have numbers, we can have strings, You can actually have other arrays if you want, which I'll get into in a little bit. You can have objects, which I haven't talked about yet. You can have every type of thing, including functions.
How about when they accept Boolean?
Yes.
How would you?
That all works. So to prove it to you, I will run this program. That's what it looks like, just like we typed it, pretty much. So this is called a heterogeneous data structure, meaning the elements don't all have to be the same type. This is not true of all languages. Like in C, you have to be more careful about what types collections are. It's like with void pointers and crazy tricks. But JavaScript, you don't have to think about any of that. It all just kind of works. So it's
so
very handy.
In the case of length, you wanted the length of an array.
Yep.
In that case that you made, it was 5. But is there anything else you can do with length besides just count how many numbers in an array?
It only counts. So that's its only job. You can use that in any expression, though. So you could have, for example, array.length times 1,000, and that's fine. So it's just, but that's all that it does. It's just it's called a property. Some of the basics of arrays. So I guess because I forgot to mention, you can also do, if you want to assign, so if you want to update what values are in our array, so here, you know, we could console log this value array of 0. We can also use all of the assignment operators that we've seen previously. So we can set that to a value by just doing equals 1,000. And that now the array will be 1,000, 4, 5. All of the update operations also work. So if we want to like plus equal, we could do which is the same as that. You can do times equals, like times equals 100, should be 300, 4, 5. Do all of that stuff that we've seen already for variables with arrays. You can also do that for objects too, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So another thing that you can do with arrays is this built-in method called push. So what push does is it puts a new value on the end of your array. So we have an array, this has two elements, right? 8 and 1, and we push a new element, 5. Now the array will have three elements, 8, 1, and 5. So I can do that right here. So if I r.push 6, now the array should have 4 elements, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And that is great. You can actually, push can take as many arguments as you like. So if you want to put on multiple arguments at the same time, we can put on 3 more arguments. So after this, the array will have 6 elements.
Why not just add it to your variable array, though?
Well, so we might not be defining our variable array. So this might come from somewhere else, is the reason why, which I'll get into in a little bit. But you're not always defining your variable statically in your program. It often comes from a lot of sources, and you want to modify that later. Okay, so that's push. It just sticks things on the end. And these are called built-in methods, and there's a huge list of these later on in the presentation. So if you want to dig down into all of the details about where these things live, how they work, what you can do, it's in there later. But question, yeah?
I was going to ask if it's the same as keywords, or if keywords are the same thing as those.
Keywords are different. We'll see some examples of keywords in the object section. But an example of a keyword would be like if or else.
Uh-huh.
Sort of like syntactic, like var,
like
var.
Document, write.
Those are just ordinary variables defined in the browser by the DOM.
Oh, I thought those were keywords.
No,
okay.
Document and that stuff aren't keywords.
Oh, gotcha.
If and else.
I didn't know the browser had its own defined like variables.
Yeah.
Inside of it.
Yeah, there's tons of them. Yep.
What's the difference between using push and the plus operator to add on to the end?
So you can't actually use the plus operator to add onto an array.
Okay.
I think if you do that, it'll just coerce it into a string, which will look really weird. So I can try that. So you can try that, but I don't think that would do anything meaningful. I think it would put 6 in parse it to a string, and now we're dealing with strings. Just, yeah, it's good to steer clear of those kinds of features because they behave really weirdly. Yeah, so that's push. Oh, push.
This may be inconsequential for current where you are right now, but can array have not just a range but a domain? Like, is it possible for it to be like a matrix?
Oh, like a multidimensional?
Right.
Yes, so you can nest them, which I will talk about a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you can put arrays inside of arrays, and then you get like, I forget if this is row or column major, but yeah, something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and I'll show you how to index those in a later section. Okay, so another thing we can do that's the opposite of push is called pop. So pop takes something out of the end of the array and returns it. So the array is modified, and the return value of pop is the element that got removed. So we have an array with three elements. We call xs.pop. That function returns the last element, which will be 3, and it modifies the array so that pop, so that 3 is no longer on that array. So it sort of like shortens the array. So xs then has two elements. So the resulting array will be 10, 6, and then top element is 3. So, something neat. Question?
If you pass that in argument, will it go to the indices, or...?
I don't know offhand, because I don't use pop very much. Let's find out. No, it won't.
Well, okay. Well, let's make it up.
The question was, if you put numbers here, does it do anything special?
I don't think pop takes any arguments.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't appear to take any arguments, but yeah. So there's an operation that's like pop, called shift, that instead of popping off the end, it takes something from the beginning. So this is just like the previous example, but now it's going to be one is the thing that's shortened from, so it shortens from the left-hand side.
Can you insert something into the middle?
You can with splice.
Oh.
I didn't put that in the notes, but if you want to see it, I can do it really fast. Because it's pretty confusing to wrap your head around it first. But once you get good at it. So splice takes three arguments, or fewer or more. It's this thing called variable arity, which means that it can take as many arguments, or as few arguments as it likes. But the first argument is the offset. So if we want to start at element 1, which will be at 4, then the next one is the number of elements to remove. Remove one element, and then all of the additional arguments are what you want to insert in place of the deleted elements. So we can put like 8, 9, 10. This will result in an array that should be 3, 8, 9, 10, 5. That's how you do that. But why don't I actually run this to make sure? Yes, it does. What I said is true. In the back.
I couldn't hear it over the clanging. The first two values are for the index you want to start at, and then how many you want to shift over, what you said?
Yeah, the first one is the offset into the array. The second one is the number of elements to remove. So if you don't want to remove any elements, set it to 0, but otherwise you can, like, it starts deleting elements at that index, and all of the additional arguments will be inserted into the array at that location. That's how splice works, which is not in the notes, but I can add it later. There's another thing, though, called slice, not splice, but slice without a P, and that just returns a new array that's sort of like a subsection of the existing array. So you can do things like xs dot, in this case, like array.slice 2 comma 3, which will be between elements 2 and 3, which we go 0, 1, 2 is a C, and then 3 will be to here. Wait, is that actually right?
I think it's where it starts and then 3F.
I think my notes are actually wrong, because it should be the two indexes. Let me just run this program. That should be C E, not C E E. Oh, it's actually just C. Yeah. The first one is just C because it's an open. versus a closed range.
Okay.
To make the notes correct, it would be 5, 2 to 5, because it's like starting at index 2 up to 3, 4, and not including 5, so it's like less than the second one.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll just modify the
indexes. You just practice and you use it a lot and you look it up continuously, and then finally you remember how it works. Yep.
Will it modify the existing array?
It does not modify the existing array. It returns a new array, and the original array is not modified. Yep. Or if you leave off the second argument, it will just skip ahead to the index and return everything past that point. So the last example is correct. It just skips to index 1 and returns everything after first.
When would you want to use these functions?
Okay. You would use these functions when you have exactly the problem that they solve, I guess. So, if you have an array, just so happens, for whatever circumstance, you have an array, it's like, oh, this array is really great, but it has some garbage in the front that I don't care about. There's an example of one of those later, of process.argv in node. There's some garbage in the front that you mostly never care about. You're just like, I want just the stuff starting here. I want that stuff. That's what. Yeah, so this is a pretty common thing in programming those. You get some data, it's got some garbage that you don't care about, and it's got some parts that are the good parts, and you just want to kind of massage the data and pick up pieces, just like we were doing with the head and tail in the command line, pretty much. Okay, so if you want to read everything that arrays can do, this tiny link, which is in the notes, don't copy it from my slides because I'm going to go on, but has, so there's this website called MDN, Mozilla Developer Network, and it has everything. So this is the website you should use to learn about all of this stuff in JavaScript, all of the built-ins, like all of these methods. You can go to like the array methods, and it has an exhaustive list of everything that you can do with arrays. So push, reverse, shift, sort, splice, concat, join, slice, which I won't get into everything, but that's how you find it. Question?
There's another. I just like to tell everybody about this site. It's called devdocs.io. Have you used that before?
No, I don't.
You should check it out. Look at it really quick. It's the same thing, but it's documentation of everything. Like C, every single language.
Okay.
I found it torn up.
Yeah, it's really good.
Mm-hmm. But it's from MDN.
It takes from MDN, yeah.
Okay.
But, it's really good.
Yeah. Well, moving on. Okay.
Io.
So, here's that example about when would you want to use splice. Here's an example. So, process.argv is an array in node that you get. It's the arguments that are given to the program after you run node and the program name. All of the rest of the arguments are put into process.argv. So if you just print this out, if you make a program that just does console.log process.argv, you'll get something like this. You'll get like node, and so why don't I just do that really fast? So console.log process.argv. Now if I run that program, hang on. One second. Okay, so if I run this program now, with some arguments, so node robot.js 1, 2, 3, I get this object. So it says node is the first thing. I don't really care about it. I know that I typed node myself, and then it has the full path to our script, which is robot.js. And here's the parts that I actually want, right? 1, 2, and 3. Yeah, there's 2 actually over there. So what I can do is use slice, which we just covered. So if I do slice 2, that's going to strip off the first 2 things and just give me the rest. So instead of that ugly thing, I get a nice thing that's exactly what I wanted. That's slice 2, like that. Great. Okay, so other things we can do. We can use the square brackets like I was showing earlier with process.argv, just like it's a normal array, to get individual arguments. And we'll meet, but the problem is, if we want to, for example, use something like arithmetic, these are actually strings. Everything in process.rb is a string, so we need to perform this operation called a type conversion to turn the strings into numbers. You can do that in JavaScript by using its built-in function, capital N, number. And that just turns a string into a number. So this little program will add its arguments. So we can make an adding program. So get the first argument, process.argv2. Get the second argument, process.argv3. If we just run it like this, it won't be a very good adding program because it will just concatenate instead of add. So we'll get 34 instead of 7, which is not correct. So that's where the number comes in. So capital N number. That's a function, so you use open paren, close paren. You do all of that, you'll get 7. Cool. So we can actually start making programs that take input from the environment when we run it. We don't have to hard code everything. This is a Node thing, so this is only for Node. If you're in the browser, you would use different kinds of stuff. Right, so that's pretty fun. So what are these kinds of things we've been using? We've been using console and console.log and this process thing, and we've been doing process.rv. So what are these things? These things are called objects. Objects are like collections of, whoa, that's weird. Oh, I see why I did that. So objects are like collections of keys and values. So it's like a phone book. Like, we have a phone book, we have some people in our phone book, Benjamin Franklin and Mary Curie, and we have their phone numbers, right? So these are the keys on the left, these are the values on the right. So it's a very simple data structure where you have keys and values, and the main thing that you want to do with the phone book, like, here's how we would express our phone book in JavaScript. This is called object literal notation, which just means that you have an opening curly brace and a closing curly brace, and the keys, you put quotes around them, because in this case we have spaces and things. And so we have a string as our key. The keys are always strings, and our value is whatever we want, so it's our phone numbers. In this case, they're both strings. One thing you can do for shorthand is if your key doesn't have any spaces or anything like that, like Benjamin Franklin, or pluses or times or whatever, you can just use, these are called var words. So you can take ABC without quoting it. And so something it borrows from Perl, or maybe something, or that Perl got it from, I have no idea. So, okay, so we can use objects in a similar way. We can use objects in a similar way that we were using arrays to pick out individual records. So, remember how with arrays we were doing a square brackets and an index? We can do the same thing with objects, but usually you use a dot. So, have our object that has three keys, x, y, and z, and we do obj.y to get it the y value, which will be 8. So if you run this program, you'll print 8. So just do that for a second. So here obj, we have like our keys, maybe 4, y is 5, and then computer is 6. Now pre-console.log obj.y will get 5, obj.computer will get 6. Yep, 6. Perfect. So, what else can we do? We can do things like create new records. You use the dot syntax to in this case, refer to the key that will be C, and then you can just use an equal sign, just like assignment with variables. So, this will create a new record in our object called C that has the value of 5. So this, at the end of this, we'll be left with an object that has three keys, A, B, and C. You can use the same trick to update existing records. So if we change the value of Y, it'll be 300 And all of this stuff about arithmetic updates applies. So you can plus equals, times equals, whatever you like. Sometimes you've got to use square brackets. Like if you have a key that has some funky operators in it or some spaces, you can't use the dot for these. So you've got to use square brackets and a string. So OBJ with square brackets, the key is ABC. This will get at the key ABC, which has a value 1, 2, 3. So if you put this value, it'll be 1, 2, 3. There's also what's fun is that you can actually get at things in square brackets by variables. So if we have a variable called key that has a value of EF, then key can refer to a property, which is very cool if you want to make like an actual phone book. So maybe our names would be like A, B, and C, but so A, B, C. And now we can do like console.log, get our key, call this like our phone book. Get process.argv from our arguments list, we can make a little phone book. So phone book of our key. Now if we get A, we'll get 3. If we run it with B, we get 4. C, we get another thing. So we can start actually making real programs, which is fun. So another kind of keyword that you can do to delete objects is the delete keyword. So this is a special thing like else and if and bear that you can type, and it will get rid of stuff. So if you have a key that you don't want anymore, like D, you put delete, and then obj.d, for example, will delete the D key. And if you try to delete something that doesn't exist, nothing happens. So no exceptions are thrown or anything like that. That's how delete works. One other fun thing with objects is you can use obj.keys to get an array of all of the keys, which is very handy sometimes. So if we want to just get, if we want to kind of enumerate all of the keys, just do obj.keys, and you'll get like an array with strings x, y, and a, b, c, which is very useful. So now nested data structures. So nested data structures are where it starts to get interesting because so just like how arrays can have any kind of data in them, it doesn't all have to be the same type, objects are the same way. So you can have whatever kinds of types of data you like. You can put arrays as values. So here, B is going to be an array, and then the elements of B can just be objects. Why not? You can make all kinds of wacky stuff, and then to get at these values, you just chain together with dots or square brackets what you want to get out of this array. So let's walk through these one by one. Root.a, so we start at root, which is the variable. So dot a will be this key, value is 3, right? That's straightforward. But we do root.b, square brackets 1, so root.b, which is this array, square bracket 1, which is 0, 1, which would be this object, dot e will be this value 2. We do root.c, dot q, which is this object, then we'll get this whole array, 7, 8, 9. We do root.c dot r, square brackets 2, so we do root.c dot r, square brackets 2, 0, 1, 2. So that's 3. That's how you get question.
What does the root mean?
Root is just this variable that we've defined as an object. So that's sort of like the base object that we're indexing into.
Gotcha, I missed that, sorry.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Questions? Okay, so
I have a question, actually.
Yeah.
Since the dot operator assumes that whatever you type after it is a string, how would you use interpolate a variable to access a variable
square brackets.
Key? Okay. Well, Okay, so there's the dot, sorry, I guess I was reading. The dot operator and the square brackets are equivalent?
Yeah, so those are equivalent. So here's the example of using a variable.
Okay.
So you just use square brackets and you can put whatever expressions you want. Okay, so now, let's, oh yeah.
Yeah,
data type is the key,
Key, in that example, was a string. So key equals the string D.
But like in OBJ, it's also keys. It's also strings.
Yeah, these are all strings. So keys are always strings.
Always.
Yeah, always. And if you try to put something into an object that is not a string, it will be coerced into a string. So it will just be converted automatically. Which is good and bad. Okay. So now, let's do while loops. So you can use while loops to repeat commands. So if you don't want to type console.log of like 4 and then 3 and then 2 and then 1, you can use while loop. So we can start out with the variable in state x equals 4, and then while x is greater than 0, so this is just conditional like we were doing with ifs and elses. So while x is greater than 4, this block of code will execute. So let's walk through how this plays out. So x is 4 the first time. Okay, so we get to the while statement, and we execute this conditional, x greater than 0. So 4 greater than 0 is true, so the code fires. Console.log of 4, then we subtract 1 from x. So now we jump back to the while, and we check again. So now x is 1 less, so it's 3. So 3 greater than 0, it's still true, so we print 3. And we turn x, we subtract 1 from x, now it's 2. So 2 is greater than 0, we print 2, now x is 1. 1 is greater than 0, we print 1. Now x is 0, so this conditional is false, because 0 is not greater than 0, it's equal to 0. And our program executes, and then any statements that are after the while loop will then execute. So this program will print 4, 3, 2, and 1, and finish. So there's another thing that's worth mentioning about while loops. You might have like an infinite loop, right? You might have heard of this term before. So you could have while true, which will always execute forever. So this will just, it'll print while forever. Just keep printing it. There's a way to break out of that in a while loop, and that's with this statement called break. So here we can put a little if statement. I didn't mention this before, but with if statements, you can actually, if you only have a single statement to execute, you don't have to put curly brackets. You can just put the single statement. So this says, if x is less than or equal to 0, break. So this will be the same program as we did before, where it prints 4, 3, 2, 1. But you can sort of imperatively jump out of the loop whenever you feel like. Okay. That's while loops. So another kind of loop that's very common is called a for loop. This is the same sort of idea, but you get two extra things. So this is a little bit tricky to remember, I think, but you'll get used to it, I guess. So it has three elements, and they're separated by semicolons. So the first element is this is where we put our initialization code. So if you want a loop that will like start with a variable equal to some value, you can do for I equals 0, semicolon. The next part is our conditional. This is like the while example previously, where we check this conditional every time we restart the loop. Then the last part is our update section. So we can take I and increment by 1. And this will print 0 the first time, because I starts at 0, and I is less than 4, so it prints 0. Then what happens after this code finishes is the update happens. So now I is 1. So 1 is less than 4, print 1. Now I is 2. 2 is less than 4, print 2. Then we update 2 to be, we update I to be 3. So 3 is less than 4, we print 3. now we update I to be 4. 4 is not less than 4, it's equal. So the loop finishes, and then whatever other code is below it will execute. So this is a very common pattern. If you just memorize this base pattern, you'll be okay. And it really just is memorizing and using it a lot, and then you just kind of get used to it and see past it. There's some other patterns, though, that are somewhat, like, not uncommon, but less common. You can start at whatever value you like. So we were starting by 0, but we could start at wherever we like. So we could initialize I to be 50, and then while I is less than 100, we increment I by 10. So this starts at 50, prints 50, then it prints 60, 70, 80, 90. Doesn't print 100, because that would invalidate that condition. So, yeah, question?
What's the difference between doing the increment and that way? Like, why couldn't we do an increment of 10?
Why couldn't?
Yeah.
With what?
With the loop. Like, instead of doing plus equals, why couldn't we do I? Oh, never mind.
So, when you do I plus plus,
yeah,
that's the same as I plus equals 1. And there's no shorthand for incrementing by 10.
I see.
This is the shorthand.
This is adding by 10.
Yeah. So you could put, like, I equals I plus 1.
Okay.
For example. But these, the important thing, too, is that these have to be single statements. You can't have multiple statements in there, because that wouldn't work.
Gotcha.
For reasons. So I think the most common case for using a loop is when you want to iterate over all of the elements in an array. So when you want to take each element piece by piece and run a chunk of code on that element. So if we have an array, like the letters A through D, we can initialize an index I to be 0, and then while I is less than the length of the array, we can just increment by 1. And so now we will step through 0, 1, 2, 3, and you can just index the array with square brackets to get A, B, C, D in the output. So that's also a really common case. If you just memorize this pattern, you'll be okay. Super common. So, one of the hardest things, I think, to understand about JavaScript, we're going to just dive there. We're just going to go in there right now. Functions. So functions, I think, people have a lot of trouble with. I understand why. They operate according to these rather simple rules, but kind of where those rules take you is somewhat surprising. But so I'm just gonna go there. Okay. So the first time you see functions, you'll probably see an example like this. Like, we can have a function called add. You start a function, if you want to define your own function, by typing the word function, followed by a space, followed by the name, like add. So then you specify what arguments your function will take. You don't have to take any arguments, but you can take as many arguments as you want. Here we have two arguments, x and y. So when you put arguments into a function like this, this is a lot like as if you declared these variables locally. So you have access to these variables inside of your function, but not outside, not anywhere else, only inside of your function. And so we can return x plus y. Now, later, when we call our function, we call add, we can pass it parameters, and these values will be substituted for x and for y in order. So x will be 3, y will be 4, 3 plus 4 is 7, and we should get 7. So to provide a value for this expression, like, use the return statement. So when you type return, whatever value you specify in that expression will be sort of the result of calling the function. And you can put extra things in there too. Like, if you want to do add of, like, if I just get rid of this example and do one. So I'll just type out that example because it's reasonable. So return x plus y and console.log of add of, like, right, that's the example. So this is just an ordinary expression, though. You can do things like times 2, which would be 14, or times 100, which would be 700. Right, so that's the simplest case about functions. So functions also have this kind of useful but sort of surprising property where it doesn't, so long as you're in the same scope level, which is similar to indentation level, but distinct, and I'll go into how it works. So long as you're at the same scope level, this is the same code as we had before. And JavaScript will actually say, so JavaScript operates in several passes. So the first time that JavaScript scans this code, it says, you defined a function. So now, when I actually evaluate this code, I know that add is actually defined down here. So it's fine to put your definitions after your code or put them before. It's up to you. And this is called hoisting. Now for the parts that start getting a little bit trickier. So functions also have this thing called scope. So we've been declaring variables. We've been defining functions. When we do that, those declarations live at, so far they've all lived at the top level scope. This is like scope in the case of Node that's local to the file. So whenever you have a declaration, you could basically read every variable in that. But if you have a function, something different happens. So just like how when we had those two variables, x and y, in our add example, those variables that we had, like a and b here, are local to this function. So if we try to like console.log a, that won't work because those only exist inside of this function. And likewise, the variable c that we're actually declaring with var here only lives inside this function. So if you try to console.log c, you'll get an error. Also, outside of the function, if you try to var c equals a different value, then that value will work, and it will be, but it will be isolated from what happens inside of this function. So the function gets its own local version of c. The outside gets a different version. This is important to get because it has some really surprising properties when we come to some stuff. But yeah, question.
So the function and the variable are separate, but the return can list out whatever you want it to.
Yeah, and when you return, you also stop executing code in that function. So you sort of, like, I could have more statements after this return, but they wouldn't execute only because the return sort of jumps you out of the function. Yeah.
If you name a global variable the same name, will the function freak out?
I don't remember. Don't do that.
You shouldn't do that, but it will check first within its scope, and if it can't find it, it will then check outside of that scope.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Okay. Yeah, so I think it'll be okay. But
naming things globally is bad practice, mostly.
Yeah, question.
Yeah, sorry, just to repeat, you said that A and B live inside the function, so they can't be called outside?
Yes.
Or was it just...
So A and B are only visible inside of this function, so only inside of this code can use A and B. If you try to use them outside, it won't work, or it will use a different A and B to find it.
Okay.
One of those. Okay. I'm clear on that.
Yeah, you can get context highlighting, so you just scope to the color coded.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's like editors that do things, I guess. I like this stuff. Okay, let's go. So another thing is that all functions are values. So we've been using things like strings and numbers, and those are values. Arrays are also values, and objects are also values, but functions are yet another kind of value. That means wherever we've been able to use a value previously, like in square brackets or within an expression, you can also put a function. So here's the most common way that you'll see that manifest. You can like have a function, and when you do this, you don't need to give it a name. So here, there's no name there where it would normally go. We give it our arguments, and when we have this expression, that evaluates to be that function value. So you can just use a variable, like you can use var to stuff that into a variable called add. And this is pretty much the same as the previous one. You just don't get hoisting when you do it this way. But it has some other nice properties. So that'll just work like you might think. You have a function called add, and you just call it like normal. Question.
Sorry, did you already explain what hoisting was?
Yes. Hoisting is where, if you declare their functions this way, you can put them in this order, or you can like move this function before.
Oh, okay.
Use it. Yeah. You don't get that when you use a variable like this, because it's just, it's like a statement that executes in an order.
So it has to be before you use it. You have to declare it before you use it.
Yes, when you do it this way.
Okay.
Okay. But this way is mostly used to describe how we can do some other things. So I think the next step you can take this idea, and it goes very far, is you can do something like, so if functions are just ordinary values, then we can just put them wherever we put an expression, and to call a function, you just put an open paren and a closed paren, right? So you can have a function and then just call it right away. So this code will execute with these arguments, 3, 4, and 5, which will be 3 plus 4 is 7, plus 5 is 12. And so now sum will be the return value of this function, which should be 12. Which is just something you can do when you kind of realize that functions are ordinary expressions like any other, and functions are values. So you can use this, and you could even do something wacky like this, because right, if this part right here up to the closing paren, this whole part starting function to there, is an expression, then that will be 12. And so 12 times 2 is 24. 24 plus 100 is 124. So that also works.
Because it's outside.
Because what?
It's the multiplication of 2 is outside of your defined function.
Yes. So this finishes, and then it's just a value. So it's the value 12. Right. Okay. So it's important to understand that, not because it's useful, but because it kind of gets us toward this idea, which is higher order functions. So another thing that's very important that you see a lot in JavaScript is, because functions are values and they can appear anywhere in expressions, we can put them anywhere we like. So here, I have a function called binary. And binary takes two arguments. It takes like two numbers, probably A and B. Then the third argument is an operator, and I expect operator to be a function, right? So I'm going to call operator with arguments that I was given the function. So this is like applying these two arguments, A and B, to whatever function was passed in. So if I define a function like add, that takes A and B, that's like an ordinary function, we've already seen this, you can call binary with like 3, 4, and a custom function like add that says what to do with those two arguments. So this will print 7, because 3 plus 4, and I've given it a function to call on 3 and 4, which is the add function. So now binary takes that add function, which is set to operator, and it calls operator, which is the add function we've supplied with 3 and 4. So take a moment, make sure that you understand this idea. This is super important. I think one thing that helps is if you kind of just you skip over this and you start reading it left to right. Okay, console.log. Okay, binary. We're going to call a binary function. Okay, so we're going to give it three arguments. A number 3, a number 4, and a function add, right? That's just a value, right? We can do that. Add as an ordinary value. So now we're in the binary function. A was set to 3, so we have A is 3, B is 4, operator, that equals the add value that we passed in previously. Now operator is add. If operator is a function, which it is, right? Add is a function, so operator is a function. If operator is a function, we should be able to call it. So we do. Operator, open paren, A, comma B is 3, 4. So we call operator, which is add, with 3 and 4, so it's 7. Okay. Any questions? Because super, super important that you get at least this idea. Yep.
I'm confused on the operator and the add.
about it.
So, alright, your function is A, well, your function is binary. Binary is A, B, an operator.
Yes.
And then, okay, I get the return part.
Yep.
Alright, but then your next function is add. So, when you do the console log, you're not having anything to do with the operator. You're only having to do your second function, it looks like.
Well, so I'm calling binary with three arguments, right? So that's A, that's B, in binary, right, in the binary function, because we're passing these. The third one is add, right? Add is this function. These
right.
are the same. So now, in binary, add is the same as operator, right? Because it's like substitution. So add goes into this slot for operator. Okay, so the operator is a function, so we can call it. We can call it with whatever arguments we like. So it all shakes out
maybe
to be 7.
I'll take your brain more later.
Okay, that's good.
Maybe it's confusing because it's kind of a silly example, but I think the idea is, correct me if I'm wrong, like the word operator there is just like a placeholder that allows you to define whatever function and decide when you call.
So we can take this example. Maybe we had a multiply function. We can use the same binary function to pass in 3 and 4 and multiply, and then it will be 12. Right?
Right.
Yep.
So you need to make sure that you're passing the right amount of variables to your operator, right?
But that's just true whenever you call a function. Okay.
We'll do it later.
You might also pick it up with the rest of the examples. I sort of built on the same. But I think you're not too far off.
You're not
far. Yeah. This example is not actually useful, so maybe that's maybe that's why. But I'll get into a useful one in just a sec. But I saw a hand go up.
I was going to say, the main idea is functions can be passed as arguments.
Yeah, functions, exactly. Functions can be passed as arguments.
Or return.
Yeah, or return. But I'll get to that.
Okay.
But first, so one other thing that you see all the time, right, I'll just go between these two, right, before we had our function outside, we passed it in, right, it's also really common, and you'll see this a ton, and it will look confusing if you're new to JavaScript, but you can just include an inline function wherever you would pass in a named function before. So before, that function lived outside, and we called it add. We don't have to do that because functions are values. We can define them inline. So we can put that function in wherever we need to. So this is the same program as the last program. It's important to also understand that because you'll see it all over the place. And especially in node programming, in JavaScript, you'll see callbacks, which are based on this idea. And you'll see them called inline. Says this function will go into this slot called operator. So when binary calls, it will use that function. Okay.
So it's the same thing.
Yes, it's the same as the previous program.
And so equally, we could replace the operator with the multiplier for a subtract.
Yeah, you could. Absolutely. Okay, great. These are called higher order functions when you pass functions as arguments. You might hear that term.
So automatically recognize it as a function if, so like binary, it automatically recognizes operator as a function because of how you defined it, inside the code.
A binary function doesn't have to recognize anything.
Okay.
How it works is binary just says, okay, give me three things. This says, give me three things. So you give it three things. Whether or not they're functions, like whether or not operator is a function, it will try to call it like a function. So if it's not a function, it'll error.
Because of the notation below it.
Yeah, the notation below it uses operator as a function.
Okay.
And so if it's not a function, it just won't work. Okay. Yeah.
I was just going to say unnamed functions are often referred to as anonymous functions.
Yeah, you also hear that term, anonymous function. Okay. Which just means there's no name. You can put a name, but you don't have to. Okay. That program we saw before is also the same as this program, which is totally unreadable, but this is the same. Because a according to that property of like substitution, mm-hmm. we can take that idea and like, well, actually, we could just stick the binary function right there. Why not? The reason why not is because it looks really unreadable. But you can do this. So this is the binary function from before. We just call it in place with another function that we also declare inline. Yeah, so it looks really gross, but you can do that. And you'll see code like this. So if you see code that looks like that, that's what's going on. It's.
Do you think you could show a real world example of this?
Yes, here's your real world example. So math is something that's built into JavaScript. It's built into arrays. So whenever you have an array, you can call .map on it. And when you call .map, what it does is, so we have an array, 3, 4, 5, right? And we call .map. Map takes a function as its argument. And so we give it a function here, plus 50, right, is our function. And plus 50, all that it does is it returns its argument x plus 50. So 3 will be 53, 4 becomes 54, 5 becomes 55. And if map returns a new array that has that value. So this is an example of where you might see a real world example that's very common actually for higher order functions. Plus 50 is just an ordinary argument. You also sometimes see these, we could also write this inline, so that's also super common. So instead of having a named function called plus 50, we could just get rid of that name, take this chunk of code, stick it right in map, which is like similar to this example that uses for each, which is similar to map, but it doesn't create a new array. So you don't have to have a return value. This is a lot easier to remember than remembering all that stuff with for, var I equals 0, semicolon, I is less than array.length, semicolon, I plus plus, postgren. So this is a little bit nicer to remember if you're okay with functions. So there's that. Yeah, so this program, maybe you could describe what this program would do.
So, for each loop over, wait, so what am I describing?
How for each works is, I guess I can just so how for each works is it's similar to map. It says, internally, it has that for loop in it, so it walks over each element in the array, and it will execute the function that was provided to it for each element. So the first time that this function runs, x will be 7. The next time that it runs, it'll be 8. And the next time it runs, it'll be 9. So it will print out x 7, 8, 9. That'll be the output of this program. There's more. Don't worry, there's so much more. There's not so much more. Only a few more things. Okay. So now we get into the really crazy stuff. Go ahead. This is absolutely say your question now, not later.
Okay, well, I was just curious if we could actually combine the map with the last function, like for instance, we could, you know, have it be 7 plus 50, 8 plus 50, 9 plus 50, and whether we could do it as neatly as the mapping from before.
Which part?
Our return is 7.
There's
character return, 8. How would we be able to apply the mapping function so that we get, you know, 57 character turn, 58 character turn, 59?
Oh, yeah, you just do x plus 50, or you call plus, or you call plus 50 on x.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so for each doesn't create a new array, and it doesn't care about what the return value is. So it's just for looping over elements. And usually doing some kind of I.O., like console.log is a form of I.O., so it goes out to modify something. And
So you just answered my question. So map will create a new array.
Yes.
And for each would modify the array.
For each does not modify the array.
Okay.
But it just executes this function for every element in that array.
This is a dumb question, but you didn't specify any variable for x. So the for each function just knows that x is going to be.
No. So the reason why this works is that x is an argument. So when you create a function, you get to decide what your arguments are called. And then when someone calls your function, they provide the values for those arguments, but no names. So whatever names are internal to your function. The only thing that, the part that you get to decide is what they're called and like which name is like in what place.
So if I wanted to put y there, it would be the same result?
Yes,
the term?
It would be exactly the same.
Okay.
If you also update this part. Yeah, comes to thought.
It has to be y in both places.
Yeah.
Question. Technically it's a parameter, not an argument. An argument is what you pass in.
Okay,
parameter.
None of that, please.
Okay.
Okay. So, I don't think so. Okay, so, returning a function. So, we can return any kind of value, right? So we can return numbers and strings and booleans. We can also return functions, which is building upon all of the other things we've talked about. We can make a really cool little machine. So functions are basically little machines, right? They take inputs and they produce outputs. So what if the output of our function is another function? So this would be like a machine, like an assembly line that makes cars. Well, a car is another kind of machine, right? So we have good metaphors for this kind of thing already. So that's what I'm doing here. I have a counter function. When you call this function, you get back another function. And we also have some states. We have a variable, times equals zero. And when we first call the function, times is zero, but every time we call the returned function, which will be c in this case, times will be modified, so it will be incremented by one, and we'll return the new value of times. So if we call this this function, then a variable will update. So the first time we call it, we'll get one. The second time we call it, we'll get two. The third time, we'll get three, and so on. So we're using this this property of scoping with functions, and we're using this idea that, well, actually, functions are just normal values. They're normal expressions. We can just return functions just the same as we return any other kind of value. And we can create, this is sometimes called a closure, this pattern of doing things. You might hear it called. So that's what that does. So I can show you an example of this. So if you're doing a lot of programming with Node especially, or even ordinary JavaScript stuff, you'll run into this pretty, like, relatively quickly as you start building things. So because you'll want to like encapsulate state. So we can make a little machine where x starts at 100, and every time we call a function, we can like add n, for example, right? And we'll return the new value of x. So if we call our function, now a is another function, right? Because f returns a function when you call it. So if we call a the first time, let's see, if we call a with a 1, then this says that, well, x started out as 100, and we can actually access, we can keep accessing x inside of our inner function, even though this function like returns something. All of these variables are still available to us. So if you do x plus equals n and then return x, so the first time we do that, we'll get 101. The next time we do that, like if we do the same thing again, a of 1, we'll get 102. And if we do that again with a different value, like 10, we should get 102 plus 10, which is 102 plus 10, 112. And so this is a way that's actually rather common to encapsulate or to hide information. The reason why you might want to hide information when you're programming is that you want to make sure that there's not too many variables ever in the same place, because then you'll only have to think about what's going on in small pieces of code instead of across the whole program. So imagine a program where you have 100 variables all at the same scope. That wouldn't really be very easy to work with, because anytime you want to make a new variable or make something else, then you'll be really confused. But you can use something like this property of doing encapsulation to run sort of maintain state internally. Another nice thing is that if we call f again, we'll get a different x. So if I call x again to make b, and if I, at the end here, do b of 1, I'll get 101, not 113, because the value that x is for each time that we call f is different. Okay. So, are people's minds melting yet? This is a bit dense, but it's really important. So, if you have any questions,
wait for Johnny.
Okay.
The only question I have is, when does it restart? When you reinitialize, when you relaunch the code?
What restart?
Like saying every time you call A, it'll remember the value for X within
yes.
that function of A.
Only because we returned a function.
Okay.
If you return a function and you call that returned function, you'll have access to everything that was in that scope of the parent function.
I guess my question is, how do you call it again without retaining the old values? Like, you know, you keep adding 1 to x and then 1 to x and then 10 to x by calling a and increment. So how does it reset x back to 100?
So the reason is there are two x's. There's a's x when you call f, and there's b's version of x, and they're separate.
Right. No, like, I want to call a again, but I want x to revert back to its initial value.
Then you can't.
You can't. Okay.
You can't. You've got to either create a new version or a new version of like calling f and getting the function back, or you have to like put a reset function in here.
Okay.
So you could use an object for that, which I'll talk about in a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Are you talking about differences between variables a and b now? Is that what you were just talking about?
Yeah. So we were talking about what happens when you to x when you like have the a and b. So, but these are isolated. So this time x is 100 and no matter what we do to A, B's version of F will be separate from those operations. They're isolated.
As long as you define that. Because right now it's the exact same function for both.
It's the exact same function, but when you run that function, you get a separate copy of X.
You start back at 100.
Yeah. You don't start, you start back with a new version. You don't change the other versions of X. It's like parallel universes. Whenever you call a function, you go into kind of a parallel universe where all of the variables are separate.
Couldn't you just define a particular function and then call it multiple times?
Define a function and call it multiple times?
With different arguments? Like, so you could just say, the function is x plus 1, right? And then just say, function of 3. Oh, but you can't keep interacting with that.
Yes, so that function would not maintain state. It would be stateless. This function is stateful because we have some variables that we can keep track of. So we can keep track of things over time. This is an important thing because you see this a lot.
So if you remove variables or the variable keyword, would that reset it at 100 every time, or it would still store the value?
If I remove which part?
The variable x. If you use the x is equal to 100.
If I do this, you mean?
Yeah.
That will create a global. This is something different.
Okay.
But maybe if you mean this, right? This would use the same value of x for every instance.
Okay.
Because it doesn't live inside the function, so it doesn't get created every time. It doesn't get created new every time you call the function.
Okay.
This would be using the same x.
Okay.
So a and b would do the same, would like have the same value of x.
Okay.
But if you move it inside, you don't get that property.
So what happens when you say va b equals f? Is it like inside a computer, it's like making a copy of the whole thing for you so that a doesn't interact with b at all?
Yes. Whenever you call a function, whatever variables you define are unique to that when you call them. So everything gets created new every time. So these variables, like if I call f again, I get a different x. Okay. That's that single example. Okay. So this is returning a function. So a similar thing that you might want to do that's a little bit more practical is if you want to kind of group different kinds of functionality, you can return an object that has values as functions. And this behaves in a very similar way to the previous example, except we pass in the initial value as an argument, then we modify it internally. So we could pass in 100, for example, that initializes value to 100. And then when we call add, that will add 5 to 100 and return the new value, so 105. And if we call multiply, it's based off of whatever value is because we're modifying it. So if it's 105, we multiply by 3, we'll get 315. And we get that value. This is the same idea, except instead of declaring a separate variable, we're using something that was already provided to us. But it's almost the same program. That's the trick, right? It just looks a little nicer because it's, I don't know, it's a little more concrete and does multiple things. It's almost the same program, though. Yep. So another way that you might see this kind of functionality expressed is with this thing called, is with this feature called constructors. So constructors are a little bit, if you've ever, so, constructors are kind of copied from other languages like C++, that kind of thing, into JavaScript. They're still useful, but they're a bit weird. So with a constructor, we can write that previous example, basically, where we have an add and a multiply function in this style. So first of all, you have the constructor function. This is what gets called right away. So we can set up things like state. And to preserve state, you can assign onto this magical thing called this, literal this, the word this. That's an object that gets created when you use this operator called new. So if you put new in front of a function and give it some arguments, JavaScript will create a new, it's called an instance of your function. So we're storing that instance in the variable called n. So n.value will be 100 to start with. So then we do n.add, just like before with 5. So this function fires. They're called methods, which are things you can do with your object, just like you can do array.map, that's a method, just like you can do, what other ones have I covered?
Object.keys,
well, I don't think
no.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, maybe I did.
Yeah,
okay.
Sure?
Yeah, I did. That's not method, though.
Oh.
Right. I'm sorry.
Length?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, length is a property. It's similar, but not quite. Yep.
So is that the key value pair is what you're doing, this dot value, or is that just...
Yes, so
it is.
This
okay.
is an object that's kind of special that gets created automatically. It's called the context sometimes. And when you do dot value, you're accessing a key called value, and
okay.
you're changing its value in the other sense of the word value, not the name of the key, which happens to be value, which is confusing.
That's fine.
Okay, yeah. But this is basically the same program as
this
one. Like, it works the same. The only thing is you have to put new in front. Yeah.
Your last console log entry, wouldn't that be 300?
No, because when you call add with 5, when we do that, first of all, it sets this dot value to be plus equals x, so it would be 105. So now this dot value is 105. By the time we call multiply, this dot value is 105 still. So times 3 will be 315.
Hmm.
Yeah. So it persists,
mm-hmm.
just like the previous example. It's pretty much the same program, but written in a different style. This style is a little bit better when you have a lot of methods to add and like a lot of state to track, because that can get kind of awkward the other way, I found. But for simple things, the other style is usually easier. Okay, that's constructors. Yep.
So, this used the keyword new, but the previous one doesn't.
Yes, that's correct.
So, what, like?
Yes, so we just called it. do it this way, you have to use new. And if you don't remember to use new, it won't work, and it will fail in weird ways. Like, it will create global variables by mistake. So absolutely, you have to remember to use new if you do this style. Yep.
So, can you use this without using new in another case?
How do you mean?
I'm just thinking about the other times that I've seen this used, and like, this is the first time that I've heard of an association between new and this.
Yes, well, when you use new, this, which the context is just like created, so it's like the standard way of using constructors. But this is basically just a pattern, and you can kind of like copy paste something and edit it to your needs. So, getting back though to the question about using new and forgetting that, and like the difference. So, one wacky trick you can do, discovered by a dentist in Nebraska, is to do this ugly looking thing. It uses this built-in binary operator called instance of, which I won't get into. Basically, if you forget, this says, if you forgot to put new, I'll put it there for you. That's what this does. And you just have to remember that and put it every time you want to use a constructor, because then if someone forgets to use a constructor, they'll be okay. So here we can use it without a constructor. If we use it with a constructor, it also still works, so it's fine. It's ugly, but whatever. It's just, you just have to memorize that, and then it's okay. You get all these nice functional benefits in JavaScript, but you also get weird and hacky stuff like that occasionally. Okay, so we've been using a lot of built-ins. Built-ins are actually implemented like that prototype constructor and methods and that sort of thing. So the language has a lot of built-ins. Here's one of them. So every string that you ever have seen, you can call a method like .toUpperCase, and it will uppercase your string for you. So there are all of these little built-in things that are very handy, that kind of stuff. So here are some links about where to find what you can do with strings, arrays, numbers, functions, and dates, all of the built-in types of things. Click these from the lecture notes. You can do an awful lot of things. There's also a whole list of global objects, and I'll go into more of them, but here's how you get that complete list. If you have this information, it's so much easier, and you can kind of just go wild exploring all of the ins and outs of wacky esoteric stuff. So, we already discussed a few of the type conversions you can do. So one of them is like number, and that takes a string and converts it to a number, an actual number, not just a string that has some numbers in it. Subtle distinction, but if you want to convert a string to a number, capital N for number. If you want to convert a number to a string, you can use the number, which in this case, because of the decimal point, is kind of the same as the dot operator, so you have to stick friends. But if you have any kind of like variable, you can just do variable dot toString. That will convert a number to a string. What's really cool though is toString actually takes an argument. By default, that argument is set to 10, base 10, but you can provide any argument you want. So if you want to convert 123 to binary, that toString 2, you get binary as a string. If you want to convert to hex, hexadecimal, toString 16, and you get 7b as a string. It goes all the way up, I think, to radix 36 or so. I tested it once. So 2 to 36, you'll get. You can also convert, going the other way, if you want to convert a binary string back into a number, you can use this built-in function called parseInt. So you give it the string and the comma, the base, so 2 or 16 for hex. So some things that you will invariably run into, it's like, oh, I wish I could call that function that takes a number, but all I have is a string. Here's how you do that. So another thing you might have heard of, JSON. So JavaScript has built-in support for JSON. You can call stringify, which turns any object pretty much into a string representation. So if we have an array or an object or like booleans or numbers, whatever strings, whatever you want, you can turn that into a string by calling JSON, capital J-S-O-N, dot stringify. You give the object, and then you'll get back something like this, which is the JSON representation. You can stuff that in a file, you can send that over the network, you can do whatever you want with it. The opposite function is called json.parse. That turns that JSON string that we got from json.stringify back into an object. So if we have that nested, like we have that string, this is a string, double quotes on each side, turn it back into an object, and then you can access it like with square brackets, with dots, whatever you want, just like the nested example. Turns it back into an object. Stringify and parse. Stringify, parse, stringify. So, another thing that's, yeah.
Can you just define JSON?
JSON. It's basically a, it's kind of like a subset of JavaScript's object model. So it supports having arrays and objects and numbers and strings and booleans, but as something that you can put into a string. So you can like put that into a response from an HTTP server, that kind of thing. And on the other side, you can take that response, which is text, it's always just text, convert it back into that object, back into that original object. So this is sometimes called serialization and deserialization. It's like taking objects in memory, sending them over the wire, sending them like over connection of some kind, and then like unpacking them on the other side to be what they were. Yeah.
So it's like the string version of an, the contents of an object.
String version. More or less. Yeah.
Okay.
And it's invertible. Question?
Oh, so it's just a way to like send and receive useful information?
If you have like objects in memory or something, you can like stringify and then like parse them back out again, going the other way around. So, okay. So, some other handy built-ins. One of them is called split. So if you have a string, just like you can do two uppercase, you can do this handy thing called dot split. This is used, I think, a lot in like the Node schools and stuff like that. It kind of just assumes that you know it. A lot of the time, people don't just know it because it's this trivia that you have to read about. So here I'm showing it to you. You have a string, say it's split up by some delimiter, it's called, which is like a character, a single character or a character sequence that kind of like separates pieces of text. Another common delimiter is a new line, which is like backslash n, which means like hitting return on the keyboard pretty much. Here we have a string with separated by colons, so you can call string.split with the delimiter as a string, so colon, and it will return an array that has been split out by that colon. So you can take a string and turn it into an array of strings with split. There's another one that does the inverse that I forgot to put in the notes called join. So if you want to take this array and turn it back into that string, you can call .join on the array with this, the same delimiter string, so just the colon character. Okay, questions about that? Okay. So, even more built-ins. I've got a lot of built-ins because I think that most programming materialists don't really talk about them, and they're like the most important thing about programming is actually like doing stuff with programs. So, more built-ins. So, if you want to do exponentiation, if you try to do caret, that doesn't work. That means something different that I won't go into. It's like bitwise XOR, something kind of trivia. But you can use math.how. Math is a built-in object that has these functions. So you take the base, like 2. You want to raise it to a power, like 16. So you do math.how 2, 16. You can do math.log, which is a natural log, so base e. If, fun fact about logarithms, yeah, go logarithms. So logarithms are really nice. If you ever have any kind of log function, so if you have log base 10, whether you have log base 2 or e, whatever that is, if you want to get into a different base, just divide by the log of the base you want to go into. So if I have natural log, which is math.log, and I want to go to log base 2, I can just take math.log of whatever number I'm trying to convert in, divide it by log of 2, will be log base 2. Handy stuff. Logarithms are really useful in computing. They're surprisingly useful in programming because you'll need to deal with powers of 2 a lot, and logarithm will tell you what the orders of magnitude are or something. So a good example of this is if you have a really big number and you want to see how many bits you'll need to store that number, you can take the log base 2 of that number, take the ceiling of that, and that'll tell you how many bits it takes to fun fact. So there's also exp, which is like e raised to the power n. You could also do math dot capital E, which is the constant, and use math dot pow if you want. There's pi, there's sine, cosine, all the fun stuff. There's a link to all of the math stuff that's built in. There's lots more. A tan 2, etc. Yep.
Math dot pi and math dot E are just considered numbers?
They're constants, yeah.
Okay.
So they just live on math and their values. Yep.
What would be the return on that?
Which one?
Log base 2 of 250, or math dot log 255.
Yes, divided by.
Divided by math.log2.
Yeah, so it'll just be a number, and it will be the number of bits that it takes to represent 255. It'll actually be a floating point, but if you take the ceiling of that. So, it'll take 8 bits to represent 255. If you do 256, it will actually take you 9 bits, but there's an off by one error, because I didn't go there. Anyways. Because, okay. So, more stuff you can do. Dates. Hooray for dates. Dates are super common. You use them all the time in programming because they have, because your programs exist in the real world and clocks are important. So, how do you make a new date in JavaScript? You use the new keyword and date. So, date is like a constructor that's available globally. You can create a new instance of it by using new. By default, that'll be the current time. If you want to give it a particular time, you can give it a string as the time. So, like, this is an ISO 8601 string. It's the best kind of string because it sorts lexicographically, but don't worry about if you don't know what that means. So, you can also create a date from the number of milliseconds since January 1st at midnight, 1970, which is an important day in the history of Unix. It's when they started the clock.
Yeah.
But that's just when the clocks go to. It was like in the 70s, and they're like, well, that's a good date. Yeah.
What's it called?
It's called the Unix Epoch.
That's right.
Yeah, so this one happens to be in milliseconds, so that means that you have to divide by 1,000 if you want to get it to seconds. You can also do this handy thing called date.now, which gives you that number of milliseconds since January 1st, 1970. Pretty handy, actually, because you get millisecond precision, so if you divide by 1,000, you get some floating points at the end. How you make dates. What can you do with a date once you have one? So, you can do all this fun stuff. If you do d.toString, you get this kind of, I don't like this format, but this is the default format. It's like day and month and time zone, whatever. Tell this was this morning at 10:18, that's why I was holding. This is a good one, though. I like this. 2isostring gives you this kind of a date, which looks a bit uglier, but the best thing about isostrings is you can start from left to right, and it's like year comes before month, comes before day. So if you try to run a sorting algorithm on these dates, they'll come in order, which is super nice. They won't for these dates. That's why they're evil. So, and this date format is also international, which is nice. Problem is, right, that sometimes they put the month first, sometimes they put the day first. I don't even know what we use here, because I don't care, because I just use this one. This one is unambiguous. Anyways, stop ranting about dates. If you want to get the number of milliseconds since 1970, you can do dot value of. I don't know why it's called that, but it is. You can also do, like, get full year, 2015, get month, zero. Unfortunately, the months start at zero, not one. Only some of the things are like that. If you do, like, get day, that actually starts from one, not zero. So, whatever. Hours. That'll be, like, the 24 hours. So it goes from, like, zero to 23 minutes. What you might expect, zero to 59, zero to 59 per seconds as well. So you have all of these nice, handy properties. You can start doing fun stuff with dates. That's it. So, if you want, optionally, you can do this NoSQL called JavaScript. It's really good. It's by my friend Seth from Seattle. And it's pretty basic JavaScript stuff if you just want to make sure that you got it. I covered a lot more stuff than is in that, but this is really good information as well. Completely optional, though. Don't feel like you have to do it. Here's also another great resource by my friend Max Hogman, called jsforcats.com. It goes through like a little tutorial about JavaScript, and he uses the REPL in the browser, so if you want to do that approach. That's also a really good tutorial. I drew the art for it, so. That's it. Thanks.
How much of this is node specific and how much is just general?
So almost none of this is node specific. The only things that I showed you that are node specific are processed at RV and running programs with node. Otherwise, it's all the same.
So is there a machine that starts running since the 1970s to keep the clock running?
I don't think so. I think they just use like whatever the standard clocks are, but that would be great if that were true.
Like
I don't think
somewhere in
some yeah.
Yeah. Somewhere
imagine
like New Jersey,
like in
basement of
Alps somewhere.
Yep. Okay, questions.
So the question that goes back to JSON parsing.
Yep.
And the example that you had, there was the string XY, what if that was a variable? Like, would JSON know what's a string? How does it know what to parse to a string and what to parse to a variable?
So what does it know how to parse? So JSON will not parse variables.
Okay.
It only parses kind of like dead data that doesn't have any reference.
Okay.
So everything has to be literal inside
okay.
of JSON. So you can have 1, 2, 3, that's valid JSON. So if you like console.log, JSON.stringify, sorry, JSON.parse that. If you have like 1, 2, 3, X, that will be a parse error. You can have the objects with X, but they have to be keys, not values. That won't work, but this will. Not that.
Yeah.
That won't work.